Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The Print Off the Cuff, presented by IIFL Wealth and Asset Management, corporate partner AU Small Finance Bank, in association with Global Insurance Brokers, airline partner SpiceJet, in alliance with Indraprastha Apollo Hospitals.
Beginning of a new year. In fact, we are recording this on the first of the year, and we make a break from what's been a difficult 10 months. So we record our first off the cuff physically. It is not on Zoom or Spike. Of course, we take precautions of sitting outdoors. It's a beautiful sunny day in Delhi, and we are in the Science Center of CSIR, Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, India's premier research institution, with 37 of India's best labs under it. And our guest today is its boss, Director General, Professor Shekhar Mande, my namesake. Wonderful to have you on Off the Cuff. And that too, you know, it's very comforting, and in some ways quite liberating, to be outdoors and to be physically talking to each other.
Thank you.
So as we go into more complexities of science, let me start with what is challenging me most of all. That is the description of your own field of work. So what is a structural and computational biologist?
So what happens is that all forms of life, they have some sort of unity. They're made up of same kinds of molecules. For example, DNA, proteins, lipids, sugars, they're all molecules of life. And they are common to all forms of life. And the properties that we get to perform different functions in different organisms are because of these proteins mostly. For example, hemoglobin is a protein that carries oxygen from our lungs, and the heart pumps it, and so that it goes across to all organs. It releases oxygen in an oxygen poor environment, carries carbon dioxide, and once again heart is pumping all the time. So the hemoglobin molecule is brought back to the lungs and it releases carbon dioxide. The hemoglobin is a protein, and the way it binds to oxygen, carbon dioxide, depends upon its overall shape and structure. And that's the word structure, is how the structure actually plays important role in performance of function. And this has been realized more than 100 years ago, that structure plays an important role. And one of the first examples in chemistry was difference in the two allotropes of carbon. Both are carbon, diamond and graphite. And is a very known, well-known example.
I think a lot of the people will struggle with allotropes. So please, you have to idiot-proof everything.
So, two forms of carbon, same carbon, but how the carbon atoms are arranged in three-dimensional shape in diamond, it makes it one of the hardest substances known.
Right.
And graphite, that is typically used in our black pencils, where the carbon, the same carbon, but the shape of the carbon is different, the way it is attached to different carbon atoms.
Right, right.
So, that was realized then. But from then, even in biology, how the molecules perform their function. For example, there is a molecular machinery called ribosomes.
Right.
They make proteins in our body from RNA. And you're aware that Wencke got Nobel Prize some years ago for reducing the structure of ribosomes.
In fact, if I may add here, we recorded a walk the talk with him when I used to do that for NDTV in the gardens of your alma mater at Indian Institute of Science.
Oh, perfect. So this is what we actually call structure, and the structural biology is what comes from there. Understanding the structure of molecules of life, that's where. For example, DNA has a structure, and the DNA structure was elucidated in 1953 by Watson and Crick. And the moment DNA structure came about, there was a revolution in biology, what today we call as modern biology, and it told us mechanisms of how DNA gets replicated, how DNA makes copies of itself, and so on and so forth. So that's what we call it structural.
Because a lot of what's happening right now, say the cutting edge research, which is mRNA vaccine, that is to do with ribosomes.
Ribosomes. Correct.
Yeah, because message is taken, given to ribosomes, then they go and make the protein in our cells.
Absolutely right. So mRNA that codes for the spike protein is the actual vaccine, and there are some modifications here and there made in that mRNA. mRNA goes in our own cells and makes the spike protein, and that spike protein is now recognized by our immune system as something foreign to our body, and therefore immune system now generates lots of antibodies in our body. which eventually would recognize the virus when it enters the body.
Right.
So when virus comes, the same protein is now seen by our antibodies, and they launch an attack on the virus.
So can I say that the field, your field of specialization, is actually the basic field from which a lot of this research is now emerging?
In a sense, yes, because I mean all of us have been working on different aspects of
right,
this.
Right, right.
So,
yeah, it's very wide.
That's right.
It's very wide. And CSIR, you have a bunch of labs. How much of your work has been focused on COVID, and since when?
So CSIR, what happened was, we had a director's meet on 25th, 26th February earlier last year. And by then, the first...
These are directors of all your labs? 37 labs?
All 37 labs.
Yeah.
We meet once a year.
Right.
And we meet in Goa. And by then, already the first case in India had been reported. In Kerala, if you remember, 30th January,
right.
The first case was reported. And we knew that we are onto something very serious. WHO had not yet declared it as a global pandemic. WHO declared pandemic on 11th March. But we had started thinking about what we do if the situation actually becomes serious. And by mid-March, we had generated a strategy, all labs together, 37 labs together, that we would have a COVID-19 mitigation strategy. And it was based on five different verticals. We defined five verticals. One was surveillance, digital and molecular surveillance. The second one was diagnostics. The third one was therapeutics, drugs and vaccines and all. The fourth one was devices. And the fifth was supply chain modules. And then we started working, different labs actually found that they will start working on that.
So where have you made the most progress?
So many different areas, because we were very early on. You would have probably heard of the diagnostics kit called Feluda.
Feluda, yes.
So
yes.
Our lab in Delhi was already working on CRISPR-Cas, but they were working on sickle cell anemia with CRISPR-Cas.
Now you have to explain CRISPR-Cas. I know that this year's Nobel Prize was for CRISPR research. CRISPR is, if I may say so, in loose definition, gene editing.
That's right.
Right? That's and right. These two women scientists got their Nobel for designing what is the equivalent of a scissors.
That's right.
For editing genes.
That's right.
But tell us what is CRISPR and what is CRISPR-Cas.
So basically, it's a complex machinery which recognizes DNA, and having recognized the DNA, it goes and cuts the DNA at that particular location, very specific locations. The DNA is cut by the Cas enzyme. So Cas is basically the one which actually goes and cuts it and allows some other thing to enter.
So what is Cas?
The Cas is an enzyme.
Enzyme.
Correct. That catalyzes cutting and pressing of DNA. What happens is that many bacteria use it in their own defense.
Uh-huh.
So it was accidentally discovered by Jenny Doudna and her former colleague Charpentier, who got the Nobel Prize this year. And they discovered that bacteria have this inherent mechanism to defend themselves, because bacteria, just like humans, are all the time exposed to different bacteria and fungi. Bacteria is exposed all the time to phages. They go and invade bacteria and they can actually destroy bacteria.
Right.
And they have to have a self defense.
Phages is P-H-A-G-E-S.
That's right. Bacteriophages.
Phages means ones that eat up, literally.
Correct.
Yeah, right.
That's right. So bacteria are continuously exposed to phages, which can kill and destroy bacteria. And their self-defense mechanism was, in a sense, is mediated by CRISPR-Cas. So that's how it was actually discovered in the beginning. But now it has been found out that Jenny and also there's a group in MIT led by Professor Zhang, they found out that it can be used for gene editing in many different purposes. And that has been quite a revelation in the last 10 years. It brought out a revolution in biology. So our group in Delhi was working already on this, and they realized that it can be very quickly repurposed as a diagnostic kit for...
The target they were after was sickle cell anemia.
That's right. In sickle cell anemia, there is a defective gene of hemoglobin.
Right.
That is a mutation in it that actually makes all the hemoglobin molecules to aggregate. And when the molecules aggregate, the cells themselves change the shape. The cells, red blood cells, are like discs. If you look under the microscope, they're like discs, you know. But they change the shape and they become sickle-like. And it's the sickle cell name that comes from there. And then they have a different property of binding oxygen or something. And that's why people suffer. That people who suffer from sickle cell anemia have breathing difficulties because of oxygen binding properties of the hemoglobin and so on and so forth. But then they repurpose it for COVID, because it has a very high property of recognizing DNA elements. And if we have to recognize the RNA of the virus, that RNA can be quickly converted into a DNA.
That is through the transcriptase.
Correct.
Reaction,
reverse transcriptase.
Yes.
Correct. And then Cas.
Usually in science, when you people say ASE, it means an enzyme.
That's right. Protease, transcriptase, yes, things like
lactase,
that.
Lactase, protease, yes.
That's right. So, they actually then, because it has a property of recognizing a specific DNA element with a very high specificity, they convert it into a paper-based kit. So, it becomes now world's first dip test kind of a thing.
Right.
They have used this and named it Feluda.
So, how much is it being used in India right now?
So, we commercialize it through our partners, in this case, Tata Sons, and they are selling it in the market. And in fact, it's available on the government's GEM platform now, this one. And it's being used quite widely, commercialized by Tata Sons.
So, how is this an improvement over the conventional RT-PCR kit?
So, what happens is RT-PCR requires an instrument for doing what we call as real-time PCR and with very expensive fluorescent drug. Now, this equipment itself is quite costly. It costs a few lakhs. Right, among the 10-20 lakh rupees is what it costs. Well, this being a paper-based kit, it doesn't cost that much. So, the cost has come down dramatically. Moreover, the time spent of doing the entire PCR reaction, typically it takes about 3 to 4 hours in a lab or even more for doing RT-PCR. This can be done in something like 45 minutes.
So, why is it not picking up more in India?
It will pick up because it has just been commercialized.
I see.
It's just only about a month since it has been commercialized.
Right.
I'm pretty sure that it will pick up.
So, tell us the story. You told me, I know, when we met earlier. But tell us the story. Tell our viewers the story of how this name Feluda came about.
So, Feluda actually is some sort of an acronym they have given for this particular thing. FN-Cas9 linked. Uniform enzyme linked uniform detection assay, Feluda, right? Now, we were in competition for two foremost groups in the world, one in MIT, the Zhang's group, and they had called CRISPR-Cas-based thing as Sherlock.
Sherlock, okay.
And Jenny has a group in Berkeley. They're working closely with a company there, and they had called it Detector. And therefore, we had to give a name which is something close to that.
Yeah.
And Debajyoti Chakravarti's wife, who also is a scientist, and she came up with this idea.
Trust Bengalis to find Feluda.
Exactly. That's right. And
right.
It's a beautiful name.
Right. So, are you also looking at clearances overseas for this?
Yes. So, the Tatas have committed that they would like to go global. And they are filing regulatory approval things in different countries.
Tatas have an old CSIR connection.
That's right. So,
tell us the story.
You know, when CSIR started in 1942, the British government had committed some...
How did it start in 42? 42 was the year of the Quit India movement. India was in turmoil. How did it start in 1942? Who thought of it suddenly?
So, the genesis of CSIR goes in an editorial written by Sir Richard Gregory. He was the editor of Nature then. He wrote an editorial in 1933.
Yeah, we quote from Nature all the time now.
Yes. That's right. 1932 or 1933, I may be wrong. He wrote an editorial and said that India must have a science and technology support system. And as a fallout of that, even Indian Academy of Sciences started in 1933 or 34, I may be wrong. So, 33 or 34, around that time. Sir C.V. Raman started that. But British government conveniently forgot about this particular editorial. Until Sir Arkad Ramaswamy Mudaliar, who was a member of British Commerce Council, he took it up in 1940 and convinced them that we must actually have a public support system for science and technology. And he and principally efforts of Abdul Khwaja Hamid, who had started CIPLA then. Both
So the father of Yusuf Hamid.
That's
by
right.
C.S. Hamid.
Oh. That's right. Father of Yusuf Hamid. So both of them then started actually some sort of public campaign that we must have a public science and support system. And there began in 1940 a board of scientific and industrial research, which was converted into Industrial Research Utilization Committee, IRU or something. And then 1942, eventually they convinced Sir Shantisuru Bhatnagar to move to Calcutta to start CSIR. So it was converted into a society, autonomous society, which is now called as CSIR. But then it moved from Calcutta to Delhi soon later.
So Shantisuru Bhatnagar was the founder.
He was the first Director General of this.
So, if I may also tell our viewers that India's most prestigious awards for scientists are named after him, Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Awards, and the award for biology, our guest today is one of the recipients.
Thank you. What happened was, post-independent, of course, in 1942 itself, it was
registered. I can also boast that Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar was from the same university that I come from.
Fantastic.
A little bit smarter than me.
All of us are smart in our own ways. So, 1942, it was registered as a society, autonomous society. And 26 September 1942, where it actually began. And post-independence, the CSIR Society has always been chaired by the Prime Minister.
And the British were not willing to put money into it.
British put some amount of money, and 1/5 of the money was given by Tatas. And that's how the Tatas came into being. Tatas also helped in raising what we think as the first example of crowdsourcing in India. They raised money for science and technology. They appealed to general public to donate generously. And the Calcutta Mercantile Association, they donated 44,000 rupees at that time.
It was a bit of money in 42.
That's right. Absolutely right. So Tata's also, of course, gave money through their Tata Industrial House. And they also helped us raise money through a general appeal to public.
Right. So that's how this came in. Now you have these 37 labs. Have you felt during this COVID season, have you felt that we had strengths in many areas, or did you feel also that we could have done better, that India could have invested more in science, so India would have been in a better position to influence this crisis?
So the thing is, most countries have faced this question, that were we up to mark or whether we should have done something better. India is no exception to that. The fact that we had invested heavily in science and technology over the years, last 70, 80 years, has actually helped us in good stead. You know, so basically, our scientific infrastructure could be used very quickly for this particular purpose. But probably we could have done better for having better health infrastructure. And also we should have probably had better infrastructure in handling pathogens or something. See, pathogens are handled typically in very high containment facilities, what we call as BSL-3, BSL-4.
But India has very few BSL-3s.
Correct. And even fewer BSL-4s. And probably we should have invested also in
those. So how many BSL-4 facilities are there in India? BSL is biosafety level.
Correct. And to the best of my knowledge, we have one or two BSL-4s.
One will be NIV, I think.
And one
National
is probably
Institute
in Bhopal.
Of Virology.
And one is in probably Bhopal. But that's the best of my knowledge. I may be wrong in that. BSL-3, there are a number of them. But probably we need to strengthen this particular infrastructure. If a pathogen which is so highly infective, we must actually have facilities such as those to deal with them. And also train next generation of people who are capable of making vaccines and all very quickly. Diagnostics, vaccines, drugs. We are often found wanting in some of these areas.
So you can call these jails for the virus or what? Museums for the virus or banks for the virus?
So these are basically containment facilities.
Vaults.
Correct. Containment facilities is a better word to that.
Right.
You can work with the virus in that particular facility.
Right.
And doesn't escape out in the atmosphere.
So some buzz has been created by the study that is now being published this month in Current Science, that I also took up in one of my Cut the Clutter episodes. That goes into analysis of why India and poorer countries have lower fatality rates compared to richer countries. And I mean, I kept on repeating that negative is good, positive is bad. That correlation is negative between lower incomes and fatality rates. So just explain that study for us.
See, what happened was, there's a kind of a curious question that we talked informally amongst ourselves. Myself, then there is Rajiv Karandikar, who is the director of Chennai Mathematical Institute.
Right.
And my graduate student, Bithika Chatterjee. So three of us were talking that why is this apparent correlation between higher GDP and higher death rate? And obvious explanations that people were put forth where maybe there is underreporting from countries of lower GDP. Maybe people have not tested enough. Already it was known that elder population is more susceptible to the virus than younger population, and the demography of nations is such that in high GDP countries you have higher ratio of elder people to younger people, and vice versa. So we started exploring But also we knew that people were not dying because of the virus. People were dying because of the way body reacts to the virus.
Yeah.
What we call as in medical terms, it's called a cytokine storm. You know?
So basically the virus was turning our own body against us, or turning our immune systems against us.
Absolutely right. So the viral load actually starts coming down by 7th or 8th day. But that is the time when the body starts reacting to things. And that leads to pneumonia-like symptoms, and our lungs become actually then less capacitated for uptaking oxygen. And these are typically also called as autoimmune reactions and all. And the percentage of autoimmune diseases in the higher GDP countries is higher than countries like lower GDP countries. In the lower GDP countries, the disease burden is higher for what is called as the communicable diseases.
Right.
The diseases then people can give from one person to another. Things like tuberculosis, malaria, leprosy, schistosomiasis, filariasis. They are the diseases that travel from one person to another.
Schistosomiasis, filariasis, these are parasitic diseases.
That's right. Cholera. So these are the communicable diseases. The higher GDP countries have brought the burden down effectively by having proper hygiene and making sure that diseases don't communicate between two different individuals. But consequently, their burden of autoimmune disorders has gone up. So type 1 diabetes, asthma, psoriasis. So these diseases are more prevalent in higher GDP countries.
So that distinction we have to make, because a lot of people will watch this very carefully. Type 1 diabetes is autoimmune, not necessarily type 2.
Both are kind of the eventual manifestation actually is because some sort of immune reaction.
Right.
So both of them are actually, type 1 essentially is genetically inherited. Type 2 is because of the lifestyle. You know, I mean the lifestyle we follow, that we eat bad food, we don't exercise and all. So that eventually manifests itself as type 2. Now, these diseases are more prevalent in higher GDP countries.
Right.
And so what we contended is there must be a correlation amongst all these factors. So we took in consideration about 25-30 different factors, which is the demography of a nation. So what is the percentage of urbanization? What percentage of people above 65 live in these countries? So on and so forth. The density of population and so on and so forth. All of these together, there's demography. Then we took percentage of or the prevalence of communicable diseases, prevalence of non-communicable diseases. And because there is a weak correlation between hygiene and the percentage of communicable diseases or prevalence of communicable diseases, and anti-correlation with, or rather correlation with non-communicable diseases and also correlation with communicable diseases, we took hygiene also as one of the parameters. And when we started combining all of these together, and we did what is called as linear regression analysis after combining, we realized that demography, non-communicable diseases and hygiene generally seem to give the best correlation coefficient, what we call as the R-square value for this.
So the headline for this is that the dirtier you are, safer you are. Is that so?
We wouldn't like to say that.
I know.
Because of the sensitivities involved. So by no means we are telling people that you should actually move toward worse hygiene.
Right.
We are still saying that people you be toward more hygiene.
Yeah, because it will save you from many other diseases which are clear and present.
That's right. But what we are saying is that body's immune system is not ready to look at any new disease that comes in.
Right.
And we need to continuously train our immunity for that. And lot of immunity is trained in our gut. In the gut, there is a variety of different bacteria that live in our gut. You know, and one of the revelations in last 10 years is that more number of bacteria, in fact 10 times more number of bacteria live in our body than our own cells. So we
I see.
About 10 to the power 12, 10 to the power 13 cells in our body which are of our own.
Right.
But we have about 10 to the power 13, 10 to the power 14 bacteria which live on our body.
10 to the power 13 or 10 to the power 14 bacteria.
That's right.
And cells?
10 to the power 12, 10 to the power 13.
Oh, I see. So we have more bacteria in our body than we have our own cells.
That's right. So people have started asking some very fundamental question. Are we really us or not?
Right? That's a good question. Yes.
So
are we just a bunch of bugs?
Right. And every day there's some exciting finding coming out that everything is dictated, including human behavior, by the bacterial population, kind of bacteria that live in our gut. So the gut-brain axis also people have started questioning that how our gut behaves, our brain responds that way. But what is sure, apart from this philosophical thing, is that the gut bacteria actually help us train our immunity. You know, and a kind of bacteria which live in our gut. And there is definite correlation now to diabetes, for example, or there is definite correlation to obesity. People have shown in the lab, a mouse becomes obese and a mouse which is lean mouse. If you transplant bacteria from each other, the obese mouse now becomes lean and the lean mouse becomes obese.
I see.
You know, these kind of things are now very well established.
So I think given our history of sort of eating fermented foods and dahi most of all, that becomes a factor.
That's right. So immune training by our bacteria that live in our gut is an important aspect. And therefore, what we are saying is not necessarily hygiene, but keep training our body all the time, immune training, so that any new pathogen that comes
in. But you buy the basic fact that these countries have much fewer fatalities. You don't believe that deaths are being hidden or those are not being registered because of poorer systems, that millions of people are dying when nobody is counting them.
That is unlikely at this stage, because one of the criticisms of our study has been that there has been underreporting. But let me tell you that in India, it would be very difficult to believe that there is an underreporting of the factor of 10. You know, I mean, maybe the cause of death has not been correctly recorded. We can perhaps consider that option. But we definitely cannot say that deaths have been underreported in India. So definitely deaths have been counted correctly. But a cause of death, maybe there have been some misses or hits here and there.
So it may be 20%, 30%, but it can't be 300%.
That's right, absolutely. Yeah.
And that applies to all these countries, because Africa is another striking example.
That's right.
I think Africa fatality rates are much lower than even India's.
That's right.
India's or subcontinents, Pakistan and Bangladesh are much lower than India's, about half of us.
Correct. That's very true. That in general, and this observation I don't think anybody disputes, that countries in low GDP, the case fatality ratio has been much lower than those in high GDP.
So is Africa much, much lower than us? Even
absolutely.
Us?
Correct. Some of the nations in Africa, the case fatality ratio is something like 18 per million or something.
I
like
think Botswana, I heard.
That's right.
Yeah.
Correct.
Very little.
That's right.
So now this is a question that a lot of people ask. Also, it's a question that some of my colleagues are asking, Abantika Ghosh. The debate about BCG, that do populations which have a history of BCG vaccination, it's not just our countries, but say Japan, Russia, do they tend to have lesser mortality, and does it indicate that there is some causality?
See, the BCG topic has come up quite prominently in recent times since the COVID outbreak. We have to remember that BCG that is given across the world today for perpetually protecting us against TB is given after we are born immediately, right? We don't take BCG when we are adults. The debate that has come up is that if BCG is given to adults, maybe it will protect adults against COVID. There's a debate. But because BCG has been given to in childhood, our correlation did not show any correlation to BCG in that particular sense. Now, I must mention here that a very notable outliers in our study, for example, Japan fatality rate has been very less, South Korea and all. And although these are very high GDP countries, but their case fatality ratio has been much less.
Yeah. So, so I'm sticking to BCG for a minute. Could it be, because in your study, I noticed that you've said that you did not find a correlation, but you found a correlation between BCG vaccinations and incidence of autoimmune disease. So populations which had BCG vaccines had lesser incidence of autoimmune disease. And it's the presence of autoimmune conditions that makes the virus more of a killer. So if you would explain that a little.
Yes, so the BCG in a sense, what we can call is actually an immune boosting system in our body, right? What was discovered to be against TB, in fact, it's a attenuated strain of what is called as Mycobacterium bovis. Mycobacterium bovis is the one, it's a TB-like thing in cattle.
Right.
It's very related to Mycobacterium tuberculosis,
right,
which causes TB. Now, what was thought that it will protect us against TB, but turns out that also it's a good immune booster. So it's a good immune boosting bacterium that actually helps. Now, because BCG is in our mandatory universal immunization program in India, all of us are BCG vaccinated. But it's not there in high GDP countries like Western Europe or US and all. And therefore, lower number of people are vaccinated with BCG. and there is incidence of autoimmune disorders is higher in those countries, and therefore that correlation might be showing up that not all people are vaccinated with BCG, but there is higher incidence of autoimmune disorders.
Right. So, have you got some sharp reactions to this? This is too risque, this is too provocative?
Yes, we did indeed get sharp reactions. But some of the very frontline journals thinking that it's too provocative, because what you see in current science is actually much more moderated version than our first version that we submitted to MedArchives, where we had actually boldly stated that it is hygiene hypothesis that is working. There's a very famous hypothesis called hygiene hypothesis.
I see. What does that mean?
So somebody in 1989 proposed that if you are exposed to low hygiene conditions and various pathogens continuously, you become better trained to new pathogens that come in, like COVID-19. And therefore, living in low hygiene countries actually prepares you better for new pathogens that are coming in. That has been much debated.
Yeah, we see that, you know, when we say people from the West coming into our countries, they tend to get sick with our water or our food very easily.
Correct.
We do okay with that.
That's right. Correct. It has been much debated. People have eventually said that let us not call it hygiene hypothesis, let us call it immune training hypothesis. And lot of immunity training.
So that's a scientific concept.
Correct. And as I told you that most of the immune training would happen in the gut. And therefore, maintaining a proper balance of different kinds of bacteria in the gut probably will immune train our body for new pathogens or something. That's the hypothesis.
That's the hypothesis. So, do you expect people to carry it forward, or do you think people say, this is too simplistic?
No. I think people would carry it very aggressively forward. In fact, CSIR very soon is going to initiate study with some of the frontline doctors in India, some of the best known doctors in India, to explore possibility of, in fact, this idea came from none other than Dr. Shiv Sareen.
Right.
And he said that
Dr. Shiv Sareen is India's foremost hepatologist.
Absolutely right.
Right.
And he suggested that
he saved the lives of two of my really dear colleagues.
Fantastic. He's such a wonderful person.
He's a healer.
That's right. And such a fantastic doctor. And he proposed to us saying that let us explore the gut liver axis very quickly. And what he believes is that the incidence of NASH and NAFLD, they're the two kinds of diseases, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, for example, which appears to be actually on the rise in India, especially in the northern belt. It could be modulated by the gut bacteria in our body. And let us explore that very quickly, that how it does. And we might actually do a study with him very soon to do that. And he strongly believes that he can actually have a therapeutic based on the bacteria. So if you actually have improve the population of bacteria in the gut, you actually put them in a capsule and give it to a person.
Because these days, anybody who has an ultrasound in India looks like after the age of 40 has fatty deposits.
That's right.
Maybe because we've been eating so many trans fats.
That's right. What and also reuse oil all the time.
Reused oil, yes. Yeah. That becomes trans fatty. So at CSIR, what are the new next frontiers that you're looking at?
So what we would like to do, as you know that CSIR has been actually receiving a lot of money from the projects that it does for industries and consultancies and things like that. And our financial state is pretty healthy at this moment because of that. So this money we would like to use for something which is very futuristic for our country and for the mankind in general. So we would like to actually go now in a global scale and try to see what are the global areas that are coming up. And we would like to initiate those areas of work in CSIR. And what we have initiated immediately is something which is very useful for the country, is a very high-end lithium-ion battery program in our Chennai center.
That is for solar...
Lithium-ion. So e-vehicles and all.
Right. For storing power.
That's right. For storage of energy. And two of our labs, one in Karaikudi and one in Dhanbad, together have joined hands and trying to upscale the lithium-ion battery program in Chennai. And the private industry, of course, is working with us on this particular project. We are also working on carbon capture, utilization and storage, what is typically called as CCUS. And that once again, many industries have shown interest in doing that. That program, which actually we see, we would like to bring very high-end global innovations in this. So if you do that right now, we would be known for globally for...
Are you able to retain your scientists, or do you lose them too easily?
No, it's a mixed bag, you know. I mean, what happens is that we attract very good people because of the infrastructure that we have. And younger people, when they want to come in, they can start, they have a head start because of the infrastructure in our laboratories. If you go to an academic institution, many of the best of the academic institution, a PI is independent and it's up to him or her to build their labs, you know. So they take time to build a lab for 5 years, 10 years. In CSI, that doesn't happen. The younger people get a head start by using our infrastructure. So it's a mixed bag whether we use that or not. There are many other very futuristic programs that we're actually starting, and we hope that we'll be successful in the coming time in making India a global leader in science and technology through them.
So I have two colleagues who run our science bureau, Sandhya Ramesh, our science editor, and Mona Basu, who both want to ask that if CSIR is so well endowed, it has a lot of money, then why are these fellowship payments to PhD scholars and postdoc scholars delayed?
Yeah, that's a very pertinent question. I'm glad you asked the question. The fellowship payment, the way we deal with it, it's ridden with some sort of bureaucratic process, right? Just like a payment that people like me receive from the government, we have to ensure that I have been in my office all days, or I have just not taken off and just roaming around on the street doing nothing or something, right? So our salaries are very closely linked to the proof that I am working in the lab and I'm doing the job that I've been assigned to. So fellowship payment to some extent also is really linked to the fact that the fellows have been in their place and working for the thing. So we depend upon universities and colleges and IITs and ISC to give us a statement that the fellow has been working on that. Maybe we can do away with that, just trust the fellows that have been working on this. We give 5 years fellowship. But the fellowship payment also is released to what is called as direct benefit transfer. And many times what has happened, I mean my own student has happened, that there was a mismatch between the number. The direct benefit transfer, you have to give your account number and IFFC code and all. And typically these codes are very long. And if there is even mismatch of one digit here and there, it doesn't actually go there. And then we are kind of foxed by this thing. So we depend upon colleges and universities to give us the correct codes. We depend upon them to give us the statement that the fellow has worked
or not. But you are trying to smoothen it.
We are trying very hard to smoothen it. And I fully sympathize with all the research scholars. I was a research scholar myself once. That if they don't receive fellowship, actually it pains me that they don't receive fellowship. So we are trying to smoothen it. We are trying to improve our system which responds to the students. And in fact, I'm trying to see whether we can actually establish a helpline, at least for the students, which is better. We are also trying to digitize the process where every student will have a login and everything record of that particular student who can see where the file has stuck up so that it can be followed up.
Have you seen the work of this supermodel team, which is mathematical work, which almost suggests that we've had 92 crores infections already, which means 70% of India has got infected?
Yes. So the supermodel team, all of them are close personal friends.
I know.
Is led by Professor Vidya Sagar.
Right.
And Madhuri Kanetkar and Manindra Agarwal, they're also part of the supermodel team. And they have taken lots of considerations in building this model up. And hats off to them, actually, the way they have generated this model. And I would believe that whatever they are making projections might be right.
Might be right. That means the virus is washing through our population.
Correct. Many people have been shown to be asymptomatic,
right,
in India as of now.
Because how does one explain an area like, say, Dharavi?
Correct. So Dharavi, the sero survey done by our TFR team, Ullas and his colleagues, is phenomenal. Gagandeep and Ullas and all. And they have shown that sero positivity is very high there. We have also done a seropositivity CSIR for about 11,000 people, and our seropositivity tests are also very remarkable, they're quite revealing. We see about between 13 to 15% people who have been seropositive.
13 to 15?
Correct.
13 to 15?
Correct.
Yeah.
And we see a distinct difference between CSIR labs which are located in metros, where there is a higher seropositivity, versus CSIR labs which are in...
And when was this sero survey done, CSIRs?
So we are doing every 3 months.
Every 3 months.
So we started in July or August. We have already finished two. The same population, we are doing it every 3 months.
Yeah. And what does TIFR survey show on Dharavi?
So TIFR survey coordinated by Gagandeep and Ullas and all. What they have shown is that about in excess of 50% people there, we are seropositive.
Yeah. Are seropositive. So that is the highest number that we've got.
That's right.
It's a congested area.
That's right.
And we know what fatalities they've had. So that will marry into your hypothesis.
That's right. In fact, the whole world was watching with the breath, this thing.
Dharavi, yes.
Got forsaken. If there is an outbreak in Dharavi, many people had thought that there would be a catastrophe.
That's right.
But thanks to whatever powers be, that did not happen.
Yeah.
And we should really be relieved that the kind of catastrophe that was expected did not happen in Dharavi.
Yeah. So I think I'll let you go after some, very, very soon. So I have one question as we come to the conclusion of this, which Mona Basu asked, that despite the pandemic, you started something new and may have looked exotic or marginal, which is hing cultivation in India. How did that happen? Most of us didn't even know where hing comes from.
So,
whether it's a chemical or a rock or comes from a tree or a plant.
It's a small plant that grows in wild, in conditions like Afghanistan, Uzbekistan and all.
Right.
And typically the root is what is taken, and then we take a resin from the root, and it is further processed. And the processing happens mostly in India in Hathras, that you'd be aware of.
In Hathras?
That's right.
I see. Which keeps making news for all the wrong reasons lately, yes.
So what happens is that we have never cultivated hing in the country. It has always been imported from the countries that I mentioned. Iran, Afghanistan, Uzbekistan and so on and so forth. And about 4 or 5 years ago, we thought that we should start cultivating hing because that kind of geoclimatic region exists in India, especially Leh Ladakh, Lahul Spiti Valley, and so on and so forth. So our lab in Palampur, the Institute of Himalayan Bioresource Technology, IHBT.
Palampur is in Himachal Pradesh.
That's right. And their director, Dr. Sanjay Kumar, about 4 or 5 years ago took permission from ICAR because any biological material that we import in the country, especially plant seeds and all, we need to take their approval. And ICAR also was very generous. They came forward saying that we will help you in trying to cultivate hing. So it's kind of a collaboration between ICAR and CSIR. So we brought seeds from Afghanistan. Now they showed in the lab that this can be grown in the lab for successive generations because they have to show that it can be done in a very sustained manner. And Sanjay Kumar himself went and planted the seeds in Lahore about 3 months ago. And that's the news that actually made news all over.
And you see it growing quite well, is it?
We'll have to wait and watch because it takes a cycle of about 5 years to start cultivating and start harvesting.
I see.
We'll have to watch for next.
But how did the idea come to begin with?
Oh, Sanjay has been very passionate about saying that we should try to cultivate hing in India because almost all of it we import. So why can't we grow in India if similar geoclimatic region exists in India?
Now, before we conclude, we've seen messenger RNA, we've seen CRISPR. Your test is based on CRISPR-Cas technologies. The most cutting-edge vaccines have come on messenger RNA, which has its own implications, positive implications for therapeutics now, right? Because you can now work on the body's cells to repair itself. What does it mean now for this ongoing debate and this vicious debate over genetically modified foods?
See, what happens is that there are two extreme views, and quite interestingly, absolutely extreme to each other. One group of people say that genetically modified crops and all are not good because we don't know the long-term implications of them on human health. Well, the other group believes that I don't think there is anything to worry about the genetically modified crops or for consumption particularly. Now, we know that genetically modified cotton is already in use in India, and there have not been too many objections. So there have been objections, but not too many objections.
Every drop of doodh or dahi that we eat has that GM cotton in it because cotton seed is so central to cattle feed.
Correct. Now, if you ask me, my personal opinion, and not as opinion of CSIR or government is my personal opinion, would be that GM has been shown to be safe to a certain extent in many different things, like GM corn, for example, has been shown to be safe. GM brinjal, I don't think there is too much to worry about it. And I don't think there is any study, I mean, in fact, to the best of my knowledge, there is not a single study which shows that GM has a bad effect on your health.
Yeah, there was that Seralini study which turned out to be fake and was withdrawn. Yes,
that's right. So unless we prove scientifically that GM is bad, it would be difficult for people like me to believe that GM is bad. So if you want to prove that GM is bad, we have to prove it scientifically.
Right.
Just like for any other thing, we believe in science and controlled experiments that are set up to do that. We need to show that GM is bad. Only then we will trust that GM is bad. Till then, we will actually believe that GM is good.
But you know the challenge of science? There is only one thing on which the left and the right agree globally, and these are bad ideas. And usually these are bad ideas contrary to science. So you scientists should continue to have your challenges. And for that, you need to keep communicating. So thank you very much, Dr. Mande. You found time. I know that you have very much more important stuff to do.
Thank you so much to you. Really enjoyed talking to you. And we do hope that we have good ambassadors in you who will keep taking science to the general
public. Well, I mean, at least I'm a science dropout. So whatever little I can do, minus scholarship, I try.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.